My Granul extruder now works so well that the Prusa has become my standard 3D printer for PLA parts. This is mainly because shredding old prints into raw material for my extruder meanwhile also works very well. More on recycling in another video. Here I would like to show what changes I made since part 3 of this video series, how the converted Prusa worked in everyday life and what weak points still need to be fixed. The biggest change concerns the feed line of the PLA powder, which works now fully automatic. The largest component that was printed is the lid for the storage container. This component was printed entirely with powder that was obtained from fresh PLA pellets using an industrial grinding machine. With a diameter of 18 cm, this lid occupies most of the print bed area. Other parts include a filling funnel and the base plate for the required electronics. An Arduino Nano and a stepper motor driver ensure powder is delivered downwards when needed. A sensor at the bottom of the feed tube indicates when new powder needs to trickle down. This is composed of an infrared LED and a light sensitive sensor. If there is no powder in the space between the sensor, the Arduino activates the stepper motor until the required level is reached again. On the stepper motor there is a shaft made of a press tube with soldered copper wire so that a screw conveyor is formed. A piece of that wire acts as a stirrer so that the powder in the funnel trickles down reliably. Another point I worked on is the extruder motor phase current. The installed motor is designed for phase currents up to 1.68 amps. The installed stepper motor driver type TMC2130 delivers up to 2 amps according to the datasheet. However, in the original configuration of the Prusa, only around 600 milliamps is used. According to the documentation, the phase current can be set in milliamps via G-code using the M906 command. With M906 E1000, 1 amp should actually flow through a phase of the extruder motor, but the printing results became worse. So I connected my multimeter and found that the firmware or stepper driver interpreted the command in a rather stubborn way. Only 70 milliamps are measured, there must a bug live somewhere in the code. After some experimentation I found out that the command M906 E1900 activates a current of 1.2 amps. A value that seems reasonable to me as it does not cause the stepper motor or the driver chip to get too hot. Nonetheless I glued a heatsink to the driver chip, simply because cooler is better for electronics. With a higher phase current, a higher material throughput can be achieved and the retraction speed can be set to a higher value. All in all, the granule extruder is now working very well and I have started to do more than just test prints. The first byproduct is my ping pong plotter, which I introduced in a previous video. If you are working with shredded prints of your failures, going through various iterations of a design doesn't result in growing piles of rubbish. A faulty design is simply thrown into the blender and the mechanics of the new version are created from the old one. Since I have now printed quite a bit, I can make first statements about reliability. One planetary gearbox no longer drives anything, the pinion on the stepper motor has no more teeth left at the crucial point. A replacement gearbox of the same type is currently installed as a quick repair. The new version is a little larger and, according to the datasheet, can handle torques of up to 9 Nm. With the old gearbox it was only 2 Nm. The mount of the extruder has to be redesigned again. I also ordered a couple of NEMA 17 stepper motors, let's see which one works best with the gearbox. Wear can also be seen on the auger screw. The lack of precision of the handmade extruder tube and motor coupling causes the screw to scrape the inner walls every now and then. It should be noted that the material to be printed also rubs on the screw. I will have to talk more about the topic of wear in a coming video. I will redesign the motor coupling to make the replacement easier. In terms of price, the screw from the hardware store is really not worth mentioning in the bill of materials. What else needs to be revised? Well, attaching the storage container to the Z-axis turned out to be not the best solution, as the heavy container causes unwanted oscillations. I will therefore probably put it on its own feet, even if this increases the overall height of the printer. There is still enough space towards the ceiling in my basement. When it comes to firmware, I'm going to switch from version 6.0.2 to the latest stable version. Let's see if that solves the problem with the phase current. For me, the era of 3D printing from recycled plastic has begun. Here the components for a robotic vehicle are made from the plastic waste that has accumulated in my basement over the years. But there is still a lot worth telling you so that you can gain a deeper understanding of this new printing technology and start turning garbage into high technology by yourself. If you would like to increase my motivation to share my knowledge, in addition to the build instructions and lots of other information about the project, there is also a donate button on my pages. Developing machines costs money and keeping this new FDM technology open source only works if you help finance my work. So a special thank you goes to my anonymous major sponsor and all the other great people who have already used the donate button. Thanks for watching and I'll be back.